help give us some information here is Governor Bobby Jindal. He traveled to the theater within hours. He was there giving moral support as well as information. He's joining us now live from Lafayette. Governor, thank you. We know that you have a lot of pressing concerns this morning and that your head and your heart are with the people from your state there in Lafayette. You have said a couple of things this morning, though, that expand our understanding that there is still active investigation of a motel where this man may have been set up, and that there is a suggestion that he may have tried to make a run for it during the actual event and what stopped him. What can you tell us?
Absolutely. So it appears that he actually, his intent was to try to sneak out with the crowd. Two things stopped him. First, local police were on the scene almost instantaneously. Mm-hmm. They happened to be nearby when the calls came in. They could still hear the gunshots as they ran towards the theater. He was trying to sneak out with the crowd. His car had been positioned by the exit. He saw the law enforcement, went back into the theater. That's when he shot and killed himself. Now, law enforcement has processed the car, the hotel room. I will say, secondly, I want to commend, there were amazing acts of heroism inside that theater. And we're going to learn more and more of these as we continue to talk to the witnesses and those that have been injured, as well as others in the theater. There were two teachers there on just a summer break. You know, their last days of summer, going to see a comedy, you know, get ready for school. One teacher jumped in front of her friend, potentially saving her life. The second teacher said that bullet was coming for her head, or for her friend hadn't jumped on top of her. Both teachers were injured. The second teacher was injured in the leg. She had the presence of mind, despite her injury, to pull the fire alarm. So who knows how many lives she saved by doing that. She was released from the hospital. The second teacher was released from the hospital last night. Just an awful, awful scene. You had families rushing back from their summer vacations, frantically searching last night, going to the hospitals to figure out whether it was their loved one that had been injured, or even worse, potentially fatally shot. An awful, awful night. It brings out the best in some people, but it also, look, it makes us very angry. This is a time to grieve, but it also makes us very angry. These senseless acts of violence happen. There is so much evil in our world. This is a time to love these families, a time to pray for these families, a time to keep them in your thoughts. We've been getting messages of support from all over the country, and I know that, look, I know Lafayette will get through this. There'll be tears. We're going to have to explain to our kids why bad things happen to good people. But we'll get through this.
And, you know, Lafayette, not New Orleans, not Baton Rouge in terms of what it's used to being exposed to as a big city, Mike. You know, this is what, 120,000 people. I've spent time there. You know it intimately well. These are people who do take care of each other. And you saw it in action last night, whether they were calling 911 just steps out of the theater themselves, which helped the response time, or literally, as you're saying, taking a bullet for a friend.
Absolutely. And we saw, I will look at the emergency room last night. I saw friends of a couple of the shooting victims that quickly came to the hospital. They heard the rumors that one of their friends had been shot, and they weren't leaving until they got information. Even though it turned out in this particular case, it wasn't a life-threatening injury, they refused to leave until they could see their friend, or at least until a doctor or a nurse could tell them everything was okay. They were going to sit there for hours. Lafayette's a great community of faith, of family. We're about an hour, for those that aren't familiar with it, we're about an hour west of Baton Rouge on Interstate 10. We're at a theater that's just simply blocks away from the University of Louisiana, Lafayette. It's a very normal community, a very normal part of town. This could be anywhere USA. And that's what is so shocking to folks. You never want this to happen anywhere. But here in Lafayette, here in Louisiana, you never, when you hear about these horrific incidents, you never imagine it'll happen in your community, in your backyard. This shows it can happen anywhere, literally anywhere. You never want it to happen. When one family is hurting, we're all hurting. And I think these kinds of events pull us together. A lot of folks, obviously, understandably, very angry at what would possess this person, what would cause this person to come and do this. Now, the police have talked to the gunman's relatives. And again, there's never a good explanation for why these things happen, these senseless acts of violence. I think in this particular case, the explanation will be even less satisfying than in other cases. Based on what they've learned by just talking to the family members and processing that hotel room and the car, there's never any good explanation. But again, it's not like that. Again, I just think this is going to be a very frustrating and seemingly random act of violence.
We're going to wait on the presser, obviously, to find out what the authorities want to tell us and what they may have shared with you. But ruling things out, no terror connection, no manifesto known at this point. Is there a chance that this was a specific beef, that this man went in there looking for somebody? Any window into any of that?
It does not appear that it was specific. Again, I don't want to do anything that would impede the law investigation. We will be sharing more, as you said, in just several minutes. It does not look like he went there to target somebody specifically. But again, they're still in the process of processing additional evidence, and that we'll have a little bit more to say. And again, it doesn't bring those loved ones back.
No.
But you're right. I mean, your viewers, we're all searching and thinking there must be some. You'd like to believe there was some explanation, because if it was predictable, and I heard you saying this before, if it was predictable, there was something you could do to protect yourself. Unfortunately, tragically, you know, look, I've got three young kids. They go to summer movies all the time during their summer break. You don't want them to stop doing that. They can't stop living their lives. But if it were in some way more predictable, more explainable, maybe it would help us try to take steps to protect our loved ones. Unfortunately, it does look like, again, that there's not going to be a very satisfying, not that there's ever satisfying, but it won't look like, it doesn't appear like there's going to be much of an explanation. As they've gone through his documents, they've talked to his family members, and they'll have more to share. But
right.
But unfortunately, it does not look like there'll be anything near a satisfying explanation.
The governor, as the leader of that state and as a man who wants to lead the country, the question becomes, what do you do to make it less likely to happen again? What directions does that question point you in? Do you see this as something that has to do with guns and changing the law? Certainly in your state, you know that the guns are those policies a little bit more on the lenient side to be sheltered about it. Or is this about culture? Which direction does that question point you in?
Look, I think there'll be plenty of time to argue that and figure that out, and I'm sure plenty of folks will have their opinions. At this point, right now, the most important thing to do is to love these families, help those that are wounded recover, make sure the police have everything they need to process the evidence, to figure out as much as they can about this shooter. This is a time for healing. There'll be a time for those debates, and I think that'll be a good debate and good discussion for folks to have. Right now, let's love these folks. Right now, we've got a grieving community. Right now, you've got folks that are in the process of coming back from out of state, in some tragic instances, to maybe even to have to bury a loved one, in other instances, to comfort wounded relatives and friends. Let's give these families all the love and thoughts and prayers we can. That's what we need right now the most. I know the owner of the theater has announced that he is going to be setting up a fund to benefit these families. Let's love these families.
Well, and that'll be information that will be important for us to get out. So we'll be in touch with your office in the theater to get it passed along. And as you know, what families of victims often want most is change, so that nobody has to live through what they're living through. Again, Governor, thank you very much. We'll pick up with you at the presser, and thank you for giving us information this morning. We're sorry about the loss to your state.
Thank you very much. Thank you for y'all's prayers.
Nick?
All right, we will get to that press.